When should you three-point your Taildragger and when should you wheel slant it? Is it only a matter of preference, or are there certain conditions that would require you to do a wheel slanting or three-pointer specifically? The three-point versus wheel slanting debate often becomes a can of worms, much like the high-wing versus low-wing debate or side slip versus crab approach debate, for example. Most pilots usually pick a side and stick to it forever. I don't quite understand why though, as there is no correct answer to which of the two is best. But there is a definitive answer to which of the two is better under specific conditions, and that's what I will be getting into in this video. I think it's safe to say that just about all Taildraggers can be safely three-pointed and wheels landed. There's no shortage of pilots that will claim their Taildragger likes to be only wheel slanted or only three-pointed, but that for the most part is personal preference, which is perfectly fine. I myself have a preference, which is the three-pointer. Also, I'm not aware of any Taildraggers for which the manufacturer strictly prohibits either the three-pointer or the wheels landing. So if you know of any, let me know in a comment. But with that said, what conditions did I allude to earlier that would dictate if you should do a three-pointer or wheels landing? Wind conditions, of course. When winds are fairly light, it really doesn't matter which landing you do. But as airfield winds get stronger, especially if a high gust factor is present, choosing the right landing can not only make it easier on you, the pilot, but safer as well. With the wind roughly between straight down the runway and up to about a quartering headwind, it is generally better to do a wheels landing. And with the wind between a quartering crosswind and a direct crosswind, the three-pointer is the better option. But why is this though? Why should you avoid doing a three-pointer in a gusty headwind? As we know from the roundout, through the flare to touchdown, the wing of an airplane has a very high angle of attack. It won't be as high at the start of the roundout, but as you transition, the angle of attack gets more and more until all three wheels are on the ground and is then at its highest. Let's consider a scenario of an airplane coming in to land. After short final, after the roundout, at the start of the flare. In this attitude, the wing is relatively close to stalling. The wind, which is more or less directly on the nose, gives a big gust. What's going to happen? This is a sudden increase in airflow over the wing, which means an increase in lift. This increased lift will lift the plane up. How high it would lift it would depend largely on the strength of the gust. The airplane will go from right above the stall, a few inches or feet above the runway, to right above the stall, but quite a bit higher above the runway. As soon as the gust lets go, it's usually followed by a drop and a hard landing if the pilot doesn't act immediately and correctly. This isn't a rare occurrence and has happened to just about every pilot in varying degrees of seriousness. A proficient pilot should be able to recover from this by either applying power to go around or applying just a jab of power to reduce the rate of descent and do a second flare to touchdown. Regardless, this could become a hairy situation and should be avoided. A slightly worse scenario is the same gust headwind, but after already completing the flare and just after touching down. With all three wheels on the ground, especially the second or two immediately after touchdown, a good 7 or 8 knots of gust could easily pick up the plane. Unless the pilot is ready for it, it could result in a bent airplane, as it is the worst possible time and position to get a big gust on the nose. So how then would a wheels landing make the situation better? While I don't necessarily subscribe to the idea that a wheels landing needs to be done at faster over the fence speeds than a three-pointer, in reality it often is. Since a wheels landing isn't a full stall touchdown, the wing's angle of attack will be less at the point of touchdown compared to the three-pointer, giving more protection against a gust. And right after touchdown, the tail is lifted up. This reduces the angle of attack of the wings to zero or near zero, and a gust on the nose shouldn't lift up the plane. But eventually the tail needs to come down, right? And the wing will then again have that very high angle of attack, same as the three-point landing. But by the time the tail is lowered, the airspeed is much lower, and a 7 or 8 knots gust is unlikely to be enough to pick up the plane. So, am I saying that the wheels landing is safer and you should only be doing wheels landings? No, absolutely not. But when I come descending into the circuit and I see the windsock looking like this, more or less straight down the runway, I always revert to a wheels landing. Because why would I put my skills to the test if I can reduce the risk of damaging the airplane and possibly myself by simply making a conscious decision? What about the direct crosswind then? Doing a wheels landing in a gusty crosswind is a tried and trusted recipe for a ground loop. After a wheels landing touchdown with the main wheels on the ground and the tail up, the tailwheel is in the air and can't be used for steering. And to keep the plane going straight, steering is accomplished aerodynamically with the rudder. At this phase of the landing, there is still adequate airflow over the rudder and it thus has enough authority to keep the nose pointed down the runway. But as the plane slows down, the airspeed over the tail gets lower and you start to lose rudder authority. At this point, a direct crosswind gust will weathercock the plane, and the pilot is unlikely to be able to stop it as there is very little steering possible with the rudder. Of course, the other method of steering available is differential braking, but this can't be used to steer in this situation either, because with the tail in the air, it won't take much braking to accidentally nose over the plane. Thus, the wheels landing's most vulnerable stage is that period after touchdown when slowing down, just before lowering the tail, as a good crosswind gust at this stage can easily send you off the runway. It can be somewhat countered by lowering the tail earlier in the landing roll, but the pilot needs to be careful. Forcing the tail down early, instead of letting it come down by itself, there could be sufficient airspeed to accidentally take off again. A much better and safer way to counter this risk is by only doing three-point landings in direct to quartering crosswinds. By doing a three-point landing, you've got that tailwheel in contact with the ground immediately, which not only makes it less likely for a gust to significantly weathercock the plane, but also makes tailwheel steering possible, and the plane doesn't only rely on the rudder for steering. Even on taildraggers without direct steering on the tailwheel, with the tail down, the differential braking is available to use to help steer and counter any weathercocking and with less risk of a nose over. There you have it. It's basically foolproof, although the grey area with a gusty wind, approximately 45 degrees to the runway, it would be at the pilot's discretion which of the two landings to do. But the one you're most proficient at is probably the best option.